Beloved in the Lord, our Savior Christ, on the night before he suffered, instituted the sacrament of his body and blood. But if we are to share rightly in the celebration of these holy mysteries and be nourished by that spiritual food, we must remember the dignity of that holy sacrament. These words from the exhortation of what this sermon is about. But first, let's remember where we are in Holy Week. On Palm Sunday, Jesus entered Jerusalem, and his entry turned out to be a great procession, which we reenacted in our liturgy. The way of the procession was strewn with palms and garments, and ended at the temple which Jesus visited, carefully observing once again what was going on there and what was not. Things done and left undone. And then he left the city. He spent the night in Bethany, 2 miles outside of Jerusalem, at the home of his dear and devoted friends, Martha and Mary and their brother Lazarus. Holy Monday, Jesus returns to Jerusalem. On the way, he and his disciples pass a barren fig tree. It is a symbol of Israel. It bears no fruit. Jesus goes straight to the temple, and then, to the shock of friends and foes alike, he turns over the tables, drives out the money changers, challenges the system. In his passion, no one dares confront him. People are astonished, amazed, and some enraged. He leaves, having made his position clear. The temple authorities immediately meet to figure out how to destroy him. And Jesus returns to Bethany to stay the night. The next day, Holy Tuesday, heading back to Jerusalem, Jesus and his disciples pass by the same fig tree. Overnight, it has withered. The disciples marvel. They wonder, what is going on? And together with Jesus, they go directly to the temple early in the morning. And a great crowd, having heard of the events of Monday, have gathered to see and to hear Jesus. He teaches them by parables. And he preaches that the kingdom of God is at hand. It is his last public teaching. He is confronted by the temple leaders, the chief priests, scribes, and elders. They question his authority, and his brilliant response leaves them speechless. It is so challenging that there is the tendency to see Jesus as a religious reformer. Yet his intent is much deeper. He is not battling against religious traditions. He is not battling against flesh and blood. He is attacking evil itself, the enemy of human life, the enemy of goodness, the enemy of God. It is this evil that will use well-meaning people, will use religion, will use political power to destroy him. Throughout the day, spies watch his every move. They note his every word. How Jesus managed to get away that evening from his enemies is one of the unanswered questions in the Gospels. But get away he does, And by Holy Wednesday, yesterday, he is in hiding at Bethany. The Jewish religious leaders are out for blood. The competing factions of Jerusalem have set aside their differences and are united at last in a single goal: get rid of Jesus. But on this Holy Wednesday, Jesus does not return to Jerusalem. His time has not yet come. Holy Wednesday for Jesus is the calm before the storm. He spends this day with his friends and followers. That night at supper with his disciples in Bethany, a woman, tradition has it Mary Magdalene, breaks an alabaster flask of pure nard and anoints Jesus' head with this precious ointment. Judas Iscariot, the keeper of the purse, is offended by this waste. Jesus reprimands him, saying, "Leave her alone. She has done a beautiful thing to me. Truly I say to you, wherever the gospel is preached in the whole world, what she has done will be told in memory of her." And so tonight, this again has come to pass. Judas, doubly offended now by the reprimand, slips away from the table and returns to Jerusalem. He goes to the chief priests and captains of the guard and offers to take Jesus down, to betray his master. They agree to give Judas 30 pieces of silver, blood money, half a year's wages. It's a large sum for betrayal, but the temple treasury can cover it. And that brings us to today and to tonight. I think it becomes particularly clear on Maundy Thursday that Holy Week was not a completely spontaneous series of events, and that Jesus was not playing everything by ear. He comes to Jerusalem with a deeply thought out purpose. He has made plans. He has arranged for help. He has foreseen possible difficulties. And he has committed himself to take whatever risks are necessary that this week might decisively shift mankind toward God, and, God willing, overcome sin, death, and the powers of darkness. In this first Holy Week, we see Jesus has completely entrusted his life to God, his Father. It is together that they go through the highs and lows of the encounters by the religious establishment, the upheaval in the temple, the groundswell of support by the crowds, and then the breakdown and betrayal among those closest to him. Jesus is now praying without ceasing, radically trusting God, sensing the Holy Spirit's leading, courageously stepping out in faith. His actions during this time are decisive, remarkable, and unexpected. Jesus has made plans to eat the Passover meal with his disciples in Jerusalem. This meal is a key part of what Jesus is about to do for the sake of the world. He has kept these plans secret. for he is now a wanted man in Jerusalem. Peter and John are dispatched to carry these plans out. They are given a cloak and dagger set of signals so as to prevent detection. They are able to make their contacts, and the intrigue of Jesus' mysterious plan goes forward. Try and imagine this picture as the Gospels tell it. On the one hand, there is Jesus and his disciples secretly entering Jerusalem by twos and threes to eventually meet and celebrate Passover together in the holy city. On the other hand, the Passover that Jesus is planning is like nothing any of them have ever experienced. The Passover liturgy, we heard it read in Exodus tonight. The Passover liturgy, even then, was ancient, passed down over the generations. His disciples had heard it all their lives. It was not to be tampered with. Nothing added, nothing left out, not one jot or tittle to be changed. And yet Jesus will radically alter this holiest of feasts, focusing it not on what God has done, but on what God is about to do. And yet, at the same time, others also are planning. Chief priests, scribes, Romans, Pharisees, Sadducees, Herodians, these are plotting and planning to do away with this Galilean prophet whose sense of himself borders on blasphemy. And through these human enemies of Jesus, unknown to them, powers of darkness are at work. Yet these are not the only spiritual powers at work. Behind and above all this mysterious intrigue, yet another plan is unfolding. In the fullness of time, which is this first Maundy Thursday, the loving purposes of God are bearing down on a sadly resistive world, on a frail and yet often stiff-necked and rebellious human race. And despite our sins, both passive and active, or rather for the very sake of our sins, God Almighty is bringing to us his deliverance through his Son's willingness to bear those very sins in his own body. He who was without sin became sin for us. That will happen on Good Friday. But tonight on Maundy Thursday, something equally mysterious is about to happen. This last Passover supper for Jesus with his disciples will become a meal of holy communion for the world that God so loves and that has such difficulty in loving him back. This sacrament has been, from the time of the apostles, the central act of Christian worship. So when we gather for worship, whatever else may or may not happen, the Holy Communion will always bring us grace. It is God's great gift to those who need him. And how else to get grace to us? For our minds will wander and our hearts get fixed on other things, and we meant to, but we have not read our Bibles, and we neglected to say our prayers. And as St. Paul cried out, "Wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death?" And the answer immediately follows, "Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on this night did institute and in his holy gospel command us to be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. For this is God's plan. It is a plan for a people who are not perfect and who recognize it. In Holy Communion, Jesus assures us of his favor and goodness towards us. That even though we know ourselves to be completely unworthy to so much as gather up the crumbs under his table, yet he assures us that his nature is always to have mercy. At Holy Communion, we put ourselves completely in his hands. We trust in that mercy, praying that we ourselves might give mercy as well as receive it. For this is how we become a blessed company of faithful people. So on this night, let us remember the dignity of this holy sacrament. Let us be a people who receive his love and love him back. And let us kneel now and pray together the collect for Maundy Thursday.